out there, and whether, you know, you're satisfied with what's been going on so far to get help to the people and to reestablish the island.
Okay. Mainly the DOD forces, meaning active duty, reserve, National Guard, we are engaged in three main missions. First of all, the first mission is the distribution of food and water throughout all 78 municipalities. Initially, we established 10 regional sustainment areas, and the majors were coming to those and pick up the water and food on a daily basis, especially at night, and then return to their municipalities and distributing those throughout the day.
Okay.
After the second week, I decided to increase the push, so we sent many soldiers into each one of the municipalities, and instead of the majors coming and picking up from the regional sustainment area, we were pushing the food and water into the municipalities. At that time, we also identified 10 large cities such as Carolina, San Juan, Guaynabo, Bayamón, Arecibo, Mayagüez, Caguas, Humacao, and we are pushing water and food directly from the port. Basically, we're pushing two containers full of water to each one of those cities, as well as a container full of food.
Is it reaching the people?
It's reaching the people, but now we are in a phase that we requested FEMA to change the diet. Too many military MREs that we push it out there, and we also taught the people how to. Mm. And it's a very well balanced meal, but you know, obviously, after you eat X number amount of those MREs, you want to change that. So we started yesterday with a brown bag, with a sandwich and fruit and a juice, in transitioning to a box of groceries.
When will express, that happen?
The reading that I got is going to be within the next few days.
Okay.
Hopefully, sometime by tomorrow, Wednesday or Thursday, we're going to start pushing those boxes. And basically, we are looking more into the Puerto Rico people diet, arroz con habichuelas, uh-huh, and that kind of diet. So they are making coordinations with Jose Santiago, uh-huh, which is a large distributor.
Local providers, okay.
As well as Goya.
Okay.
To be able to put together that box for a family of four that will last then between 4 to 6 days.
Okay, that was the question. So that means that it takes off the weight from your guys a little bit, because they're going to have food for longer stretches of time.
Well, it will not take the weight away from our guys, because what happened is when different majors, different ways of the distribution.
Okay.
But many of them have decided to do it house to house. Well, it's hard to reach 5,000 homes every day or 10,000 homes every day. But it's a lot easier if you establish a distribution house to house, but you are able to provide a box of groceries, mm-hmm, that will last then a week, which will allow you to come around on a weekly, mm-hmm, basis to continue the distribution of commodities. We are also providing about 320 military police in support of local authorities. Mm-hmm. At the beginning, right after the hurricane, we were supporting their efforts at the gas stations, at the supermarkets, and any key infrastructure. So we continue to provide that support. And the next effort is on the engineer. We continue, at the beginning, we established a 360 perimeter, mm-hmm, on the main roads, mm-hmm, route number one, number two, number three, the 52 highway. And then we have been pushing the engineers to secondary and tertiary, okay, roads in coordination with elements of the Army Reserve here in Puerto Rico, that they belong to the 448, mm-hmm, Engineer Battalion, as well as the Marines, that initially it was the 26th MEU, Military Marine Expeditionary Unit, but they already did a battle handover, so now we have the 24th MEU.
Okay.
And they are operating and clearing roads to the south of Puerto Rico.
That's what I was going to say. What are they doing and where are they?
They are, initially we pushed them from the northeast of the island, mm-hmm, to clear Route 3, mm-hmm, from Ceiba to Carolina, and then we tasked them to clear the route all the way up to the top of the El Yunque.
Okay.
To be able to provide fuel to the FAA antennas that are there, and they've been run by generator. After that, we pushed them to the south, But that's in addition to the two battalions, engineer battalions that belong to the Puerto Rico National Guard, the 190th Engineer Battalion, so to speak, and they took the center of the island toward the east, and then the 130th Engineer Battalion toward the center of the island toward the west, augmented with the 26, now 24 MEU, and the 448.
So do you have enough? Do you have enough people? Do you have enough men out there, women?
We got enough engineers.
Okay.
And we requested additional forces from the states. We have personnel from various states. Actually, about 19 states. We have National Guard from New York, New Jersey, North Carolina, South Carolina, Maryland, D.C., Florida, Louisiana, among others. So we continue to request additional forces. Right now we have approximately 5,300 National Guards on the ground. The total DOD forces is roughly about 14,000.
Yeah, right.
But we have requested additional 3,000 plus National Guards from other states that are en route to Puerto Rico.
To do what?
Well, mainly when you do this type of occupation or this type of operation, you get a lot of forces from the active duty. That's why you have General Buchanan here. So while I'm getting the units from the National Guard, they are here engaged in the mission. As soon as we start building up the National Guard elements and forces, those active duty forces are being replaced.
I see.
So the aviation that is here from the active duty force is going to be replaced from National Guard units from other states. As a matter of fact, I already have elements from North Carolina and Pennsylvania Army National Guard that are bringing their aircrafts into Puerto Rico to replace active duty forces.
That way you don't have exhaustion. I mean, that's probably why.
Well, it's just rotational forces. Okay. And it's a typical way of operating for the armed forces. Initially, when you go into combat, you send the Marines and special forces, and you start building up the logistic, and here comes the army, and the army will be there for the long run.
Okay.
So here is a combination of the state, or in this case, the Puerto Rico National Guard, augmented with active duty forces, and then we continue to request forces from other National Guards. We have agreements already with 44 states and territories. Oh.
So this is for the long run. I mean, this is
for the long run. It's going to be mainly National Guards from Puerto Rico and other states. In addition to clearing routes, we also combination of support with the Corps of Engineers at the Oaxaca Dam. So it's a joint effort there between the reserve here in Puerto Rico, Puerto Rico National Guard, and the U.S. Corps of Engineers.
Let me ask you: have you been able to clear, you know, the most affected roads, for example, up to Utuado and Jayuya, which were basically erased from the map? Is there access?
We have access to all 78 municipalities. Some of them is limited access. For us, access means that, you know, when we categorize by colors, green, yellow, or red. Red is no access. Yellow is limited access, and green is complete access, that we are able to fit a truck, because I'm thinking about commodities that we can push food and water through the roads. In those areas that we still is hard to access, we continue to push commodities, means water and food, through the air. That's why you see many aircraft flying around, because we continue to push commodities to those hard to access type of areas.
Okay, so nobody is disconnected entirely.
I will not say there is not an isolated. Okay. At the beginning, it was certainly some isolated areas. So that was, so we were hard on pushing commodities through air, as well as pushing the engineers to clear the routes so we can continue the logistic push through the route. Obviously, it's more effective.
Sure. Now you're Puerto Rican.
I am.
You know, what are your thoughts about what happened here and the response and, you know, what's next? I mean, seeing your island the way it ended up, you know, after this phenomenon.
Okay. It's a mixed feeling. Every day I get on a helicopter and we go to many municipalities and talk to the mayor to see what are the additional needs there. How can we be more efficient as far as supporting? But when I'm on the air, you don't see any vegetation. So that beautiful island where I grew up, it kind of it's kind of gone. Mm-hmm. But then when I get to the ground, to the municipality, you see people, especially in the very first few days, and continue to do so, they get out of their homes and they were helping each other with machete in hand, cleaning the roads and joining efforts with the armed forces and the state agency and the municipalities, all joining as a one country with one purpose in life to reestablish the island of Puerto Rico. I think right now the main effort is on electricity. Certainly you need to bring the electricity back on a temporary way, looking toward a more permanent plan, but you have to bring electricity to be able to bring the economy back, to start generating that economy, main jobs, secondary jobs, tertiary jobs.
And to prevent the migration.
Exactly.
That's an issue.
Energy right now is critical, and I think that's the main purpose of the governor. That's why he has established a percentage of 95% to be reestablished by 15 November, and we are all focused toward achieving that goal.
Okay.
Everyone is involved. The Corps of Engineers is working the power grid on the east side of the island, and PREPA is working on the west side of the island.
Okay.
That's why you see the different efforts and the different companies that have been contracted by the U.S. Corps of Engineers, such as Whitefish.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
You're
welcome.
Your time. It's a pleasure.
Thank you
for the opportunity.
Thank you.